In today's video, we're at Echo Pond and we're gonna be talking about our frost protected shallow foundation system. We're gonna talk about why we did it, how we did it, the history behind it, and the benefits of it. Then we're gonna bring you inside and show you what the finished product is. I'm Nick Schiffer. I own a custom home building company called NS Builders here in Boston, Massachusetts. And today, I'm joined by Vincent Appel from Up Possible. He is the architect on this project. How is a foundation like this protected from the freeze-thaw situation where you don't have a traditional foundation that goes 48 inches below the earth, which is ultimately what is required for frost protection typically?
The way the frost-protected slab-on-grade works is instead of going below the frost line, it insulates horizontally. So think of it as a raft of concrete and then horizontal insulation that extends out beyond that. And as a result, heaving action, instead of happening vertically, happens horizontally.
So when we talk raft slab, we essentially had framed the entire frame of the home with foam blocks. And those foam blocks were triangular in shape. This foam here is part of that formwork. And then below that, our insulation is actually, I believe, almost out here.
Yeah, about 4 feet out. So what you're referring to is the monoslab formwork that we used for this, which is a really fascinating commercial product for achieving a frost protected slab on grade.
Now you say commercial because typically you're seeing it in that commercial space.
In agricultural commercial buildings, especially in a kind of, you know, northern states and in Canada. But what's novel about what monoslab has done is they're using the insulation as the concrete formwork. So there's a couple steps to this process which become much more efficient and use less materials. Because we're doing a slab on grade, we don't have all the additional concrete of deeper footings.
Right.
And because we're using the foam as the formwork, we don't have that redundancy of having to set up the concrete trade coming in with their forms. That's a really wonderful system. It's also acting as a thermal bridge because we're leaving that in place after the concrete slab is poured.
You mentioned the formwork with the concrete guys. You know, this was new to them, though it wasn't overly complicated to install. The complication came from our tolerances. And we had really tight tolerances for the Anderson lift slide units. The home is a little over 100 feet long. And we said from corner to corner, you need to be within a quarter inch.
In a lot of ways, it's similar to a kind of prefab approach where you have to commit to coordinating all your utilities, all the penetrations, all the details, you know, before you start. And that puts a lot of productive pressure on the build and on the, you know, it's kind of planning ahead in design. And so when you use a system like that, all that has to be resolved because you're burying your conduit, you're planning for utilities in advance, which is great because that translates to time saved in construction and coordination after you start.
Thinking about the excavation side of it was that we're on 11 acres. We started doing test pits and realizing that there's a lot of ledge on site. And we knew that the location of the home specifically was going to have ledge. Instead of hammering and trying to get down because we don't need a foundation, and instead of over excavating, let's not excavate for a foundation wall and have this floating slab detail. Ultimately, what we learned in that process is we ended up blasting some of the ledge out of the way because we had to, and we dealt with an overblast situation. Looking backwards, you know, we end up with a hole in the ground and we could have put foundation walls and just put a traditional foundation, but we had talked about like, do we revert back? No, we've already committed. We end up excavating the overblast, filling that in, and then bringing it back to the level surface that we needed to.
This system allows you to build a shallow slab or a shallow foundation over ledge, which is common throughout New England, and also do it in a way where you don't have to pin to that ledge. This way of building foundations is really common in Northern Europe. This has been commercialized there for over 50 years. You know, it started to emerge in North America after the Depression. Frank Lloyd Wright was working with this type of foundation in the Usonian projects. And so it's tried and true. It's just found more traction in commercial construction, commercial buildings in North America, but it's a great system for single family residential projects that don't need a full basement, are on challenging sites. I think it also, you know, creates a lot of opportunity for people when they're looking at property they might wanna build on and they see something that seems like it might be incredibly challenging. This is an option for, you know, making something possible there.
So we had these point loads that we had to kind of battle. We had the footings in first, we actually backfilled, and then we insulated vapor barrier on top of our insulation and then stone. So we had this interesting sequencing side of doing this. One of the things that we actually ran into that was a miss on our part is we have rock wall comfort board underneath the slab, and we had all these structural details and point loads that you actually can't sit a heavy wall on top of rock wall because of the compression.
Yeah, so anyone who's planning a foundation like that, that's a great thing to flag. You know, it can be called out in the drawings, it's so easy and reasonable to miss, is that using the Rockwell insulation subgrade is a great material and great product for that. You know, the less foam, the better, but you need insulation that has a structural compressive strength under the load, you know, the load pads of the building. So you have to use two insulations,
right?
Two different insulation products in that case.
We talk about tight tolerances. Every one of these windows had to be formed because we wanted everything recessed.
And this is an architectural decision driving this. We wanted a flush
100% the architect
transition, and we wanted the detailing for the interior frames to align throughout the whole building. So, you know, we notched the windows into the formwork for the concrete, which you wouldn't have to, you don't necessarily have to do that for a system like this.
So the way they end up doing is they end up putting a 2x8 kind of on the flat and held it down. I want to go inside and actually show some of those details, but before we do, a question that you guys ask a lot is, when we are dealing with exterior insulation detailing, the thing that comes up a lot is how are you detailing the foundation? Because, you know, whether it's a Rockwell comfort board or in this case the mono slab foam formwork, you can't remove that and expose the concrete. You lose your insulation.
So to protect the mono slab foam insulation, which is the formwork that stays in place after the slab is poured, we use a Durock board on the face of it and then parged coat that. And in this case, you know, a gray color looks like cement, but you know, this will get some more fill, gravel over it, and then that'll prevent any, you know, any damage or kind of debris against the building from pulling the foam apart. The building science of this and having the continuous exterior insulation pushes your siding out further. And if you kind of embrace that geometry, you end up with a building that kind of floats and has a deeper shadow gap along its perimeter. I think, you know, another way to have done this could have been to use a mesh and just parge directly onto the foam, but it wasn't in our details. Our details were to use a fiberglass mesh and parge, and you'd suggest, and I think it was a great suggestion, to use the Durock so we had a backer that's even more robust.
Yeah, and just like those that will ask from a technical perspective, we took that Durock Tapcon screw that right through the foam into the side of that concrete, and then did that multi-step parge coat over the top of that foundation wall. So one of the biggest benefits of this is our floor finish and how we address that. So let's go inside. I want to look at that specifically and how we're addressing that. Thinking about exposed concrete, you know, going into this, using the system, what's going through your head at that time?
Yeah, so architecturally finished concrete is something we love. It's very expensive. It requires a lot of finesse. Typically, there's a topping slab that has a color that was, you know, specified and tested and mixed. In a project like this, you know, we were really trying to optimize for all the constraints, align the design intent, the budget, all of these things. So with the frost-protected slab on grade, this is the structural slab. And all we did was specify how to cut and polish it. And it's the same spec that you might actually see in a museum. It's a salt and pepper exposure. And
when you say salt and pepper exposure, explain that.
It means that when you're looking at the cement and aggregate in the concrete, you're seeing what looks like a salt and pepper kind of fleck. And the reason you're able to see that in this finished floor is because when the concrete trade cut and polished this, they cut it just below the milk. This is a sort of like muddy looking surface after a slab has been poured. So they cut just below that and then they start to polish, but they don't go too far. If you go further, you get a coarser aggregate, which eventually if you cut really far, it'll look like terrazzo.
Right.
So this sort of high design, really finessed concrete finishes that you see in galleries and museums, you know, in shorthand we refer to as a salt and pepper exposure. So I love the idea that you could take a kind of commercial workaday foundation system and just delete everything else. Just finish that to that same spec.
Because there's no special, we didn't order special concrete,
no.
A special mix. Like it was, hey, you're placing a slab.
Yeah.
And the one tolerance we said is just make it flat.
Exactly. So one thing that we have to communicate during that process is make sure that it's flat. Use a laser screed, get it dead level, because if it's not level and you go to do this, the high and low points are going to register different. And in some places you'll see more aggregate. But, you know, to double click on that idea that you don't have to add more layers. So you don't have to prep this for something else, float another floor over it, or fuss with a topping coat.
I think that's an important thing, or important topic, because when we talk about projects, you mentioned budget earlier, and we'll get some feedback of like, well, you know, his low budget is someone else's high budget. All of that comes into play. But what Vincent is talking about is thinking about where that budget or those dollars are being spent. And in this case, reducing things and allowing allowing the material or the rough floor, the slab, to be finished. And doing it in this high design way of salt and pepper finish is actually a reduction in scope as well. Meaning like they're not, they bring it to a 400 or so grit, they stop. Where a lot of times they'll continue to polish over and over.
Yeah, to mirror polish it.
Yeah, to get a mirror finish, and that's not the intent. When we think about when this was being placed, you know, and Mark is laying out all the utilities, actually this is probably the most impressive one, but this conduit here was laid out in the middle of nowhere, like in the middle of space, and this wire comes through, and that wire lands in the bottom of a 2.5 inch by 2.5 inch.
Yeah, so this is leg. Architectural sort of nuance here that absolutely is not
necessary.
This is
necessary, more than nuance.
But this is pulling the power for the kitchen island up through the leg. So you don't see, you know, utility drops in the kitchen island.
But my point is he laid this out in space.
Right.
Like there was nothing to reference.
Over insulation.
Yeah. Like I hope this is where it needs to be. And
there's two systems at play here that allow that level of specificity. There's obviously the frost protected slab on grade, but also it's a semi prefab framing package. So by working with Cape Cod Panel and having pre-cut all of the framing for this building, essentially ordering the whole building the way you'd go through a shop drawing process for a kitchen, we had kind of two layers of precision in place. And then not to mention we're working with you guys. So everyone's going the extra distance to make sure that, you know, these things land at a leg of a kitchen island to bring a conduit up through.
So you have that, we have all of our plumbing poking through, that, you know, toilet locations are really hypercritical, making sure you're far enough off the wall. We have these floor outlets, which line up with our door. This is where we go back to the recessed slab edge, where this was dropped down to allow for this Anderson track system to be installed. And then we came back and we actually infilled this. So you can see it's a different color. That was something that came up a lot. Are we okay that this is gonna be a different color? You looked at it as celebrate that.
Yeah, Anderson makes this product in particular so you can get the flush inlay of the tracks and then match tile or wood or other flooring
to it. And
that's
the thing, they're typically an applied floor, which makes it easier.
I think there's something also sort of beautiful about the expression of the raw material and the kind of honesty and transparency of, you know, it is what it's made out of and the effect is the result of craftsmanship and how it was considered. So to me, seeing the separate pour to infill that with cement and switching from the larger grinder and polisher to a hand finish there, I don't mind that at all. That sort of subtle change in color and finish is part of the texture of the building.
It's part of how it's assembled. It's like the process in which it goes together. And then I think lastly is, you know, one of the things that you guys were really specific on is your saw cuts. You know, because that's something that can be done incorrectly.
When you have a slab that you're burying under other layers, you're less worried about how it's going to dry and contract over time. So in general, what you're trying to do is create square areas of concrete. So if you pour a big slab, you're trying to put expansion joints in it. And the reason you'd want it square is so that as it's drying in all directions, it dries evenly and it doesn't crack. It's gonna crack, you're gonna see lines translate through it eventually.
Yeah, like you see here.
Yeah, and so the saw cuts help minimize that, but it's part of the nature of the material and the expression of the material. Our intentionality with these cuts though is to, you know, optimize for what we want in terms of the rhythm of the space and the architectural intent of where these necessary details, these control joints show up, but also, you know, how that slab's gonna dry because it's not getting buried below other layers.
Right. A large part of all of this and the detailing really just comes back down to planning, the pre-construction, everything that we go in, that we put into really figuring out these projects ahead of time. You heard Vincent say, like, it really requires everyone to be on the same page and think about the project before we actually execute it. And that's how you get the results that we're talking about today. See you guys next week.